Okay, so yes, what we want to talk about right here is kind of the flow that you'd be looking at being a developer. So how is Fortify going to work, in your day-to-day life? And we're going to start kind of based on what you're seeing here, which is we have this webgoat.net version 2.1. And what we're going to do is start with an initial check-in and scan, and then show what you can see as far as the scan results, the findings that are available, and then the remediation, check-in, and subsequent scanning and removal of a vulnerability. So to that end, we're relying on Visual Studio in this example. Of course, the plugins and everything we have will also be working for Visual Studio, for Eclipse, for IntelliJ. So the capabilities you have are there for all of the major IDEs that you might be working with. So you can see right now, I've got this solution open for the webgoat.net, and I've got some changes that are ready to go ahead and commit and push out to our server. So the configuration that we have right now is this code is going to be checked into GitHub, and then that's going to initiate the build in our Azure pipeline that we have here. So we'll go out to our Visual Studio. We'll go ahead and do commit all in sync to get everything checked into our repository. And once that is all finished for us, it's going to go ahead and initiate the build in our Azure pipeline. So at this point, we will go out and look at our Azure pipeline, and we should see a build commencing. So here's our build, and we can go ahead and keep an eye on this. Okay, and now that the build has succeeded, what has happened is it has gone through our entire build process, which includes a section for performing the Fortify scan, as well as publishing those results out to our software security center instance. So when we go back out and look at our applications in software security center now, what we should see is that there are a set of results now that are available in version 2.1. That's what's being indicated here. Now with the initial set of scans that are done, you may need to go into the artifacts and provide an approval based on this initial scan. So we will just mark this as approved. And then what it will do now is go ahead and process the artifact. And once the artifact has been processed for the scan results, we can see that the results are available here. And when we go into this version of the application, we'll now be presented with the findings. This is where this is not necessarily the view that an auditor or that a developer would be relying on. We're going to actually bring these results down into the IDE so that you can work with them directly in conjunction with the code. But this is another view within Software Security Center where you can do prioritization, categorization of the findings and reporting. So right now we'll pivot back over to our IDE and we'll be going to the Fortify plugin. This is the Fortify plugin for Fortify on demand. I apologize, that was for, this is for the on-prem. We also do have one for our on-demand platform. So what we're going to do here is open a collaborative audit. That means that we'll be opening a set of scan results from Software Security Center. In this case, the webgoat.net 2.1 version that we just committed the code and did the scan. And it's going to bring these scan results down into the IDE. And this is where things get interesting for the developers, because now you can see over here on the right that we have a view of all the findings in this scan based on critical, high, medium, low. So we can start working through our issues here. and you can see them by, in this case, just by category, or you could go ahead and start viewing them by other compliances and standards, whatever makes sense for you as far as working through the issues. So we'll take a look here and look at some SQL injection issues. And when you're looking at an issue with the scan results, when you click on the issue, it's going to take you to the section of code where the issue, where it executes. And it's also going to provide you, right below the issues here, an analysis trace that will show you, as we click through, you can see how the code changes. It's going to show you everywhere that this issue works through your code. So you can see from source to sync how the vulnerability worked through the code, instead of doing a lot of searching, hunting, research, tracing through classes, code, methods, everything like that. You've got this information at your fingertips, along with the details of the vulnerability, including the class and line of code, recommendations on how you can fix this type of vulnerability, in this case, a SQL injection, as well as a diagram, a visual representation, again, from source to sync, of how this vulnerability worked through your code. And again, it's interactive so that you can actually see all the pieces and parts that are involved. So this is all the information that's at your fingertips to help you as far as the remediation of the vulnerabilities, right? So the next step, of course, is actually fixing the vulnerability. So in this case, what we've got is a SQL injection vulnerability. One of the first things for us, in this case, a SQL injection, that would be recommended would be to parameterize your queries. So that's one of the first things that you're going to be talking about as far as fixing your issues. And that just means that right here, the core of the vulnerability is that you're doing basically a straightforward string concatenation into the vulnerability. And that's what allows you to be getting overruns and special characters that would allow for the SQL injection. So what we're going to do is replace this code with a new set of code that we'll be using parameterization of the query. So I'm going to replace this, and you can see that now we're using parameterization. I'm going to comment out these lines for the time being, just so that they're not vulnerable. But you can see now we've got the command, we've got parameters in here that are being fed in. And with this and the encoding, now you've got a query that's parameterized and isn't open to that specific SQL injection attack. So we'll go ahead and take out this code. And then, of course, you want to save your file. And it's also a good idea to go ahead and run through a build, just to make sure that you've got a good build on your code. Because in order for this process to work in an automated fashion, of course, you have to have buildable code. Because when you check it in and it goes to kick off the pipeline, if the code can't build, the build will fail right away, which naturally means that the scan will fail as well. So we'll go over to our session here for our source code, and we'll refresh here. We'll be looking for any of the changes that we have. Okay, and now the changes have been committed to our repository, in this case, again, GitHub, and it's initiated the build on our Azure pipeline. So this will take that 5 to 7 minutes again to run to completion, and then we'll be able to see the scan results that were pushed into Software Security Center and see that the vulnerability that we just fixed is no longer visible. Okay, and now we see that the build has completed. Now that the build is completed, we can see that it's completed all of the same steps that it had in our initial scan, including the Fortify scan and the uploading of the results to Software Security Center. So if we go back into Software Security Center, again, we can see the new set of results here. We can go ahead and click to approve this now, and you can change the settings so that you don't have to provide this approval on every scan upload. And at this point, it's going to go ahead and process those scan results into our audit findings. And once we see that that has been completed, we can go ahead and take a look at the issues. So the scan results have been processed. We can go into our audit results. We've got it sorted by category now, so we can easily find that SQL injection vulnerability that we had been looking at. If you remember, that was a SQL injection occurring on line 304 of our findings. So if we go back and look through here, we can see that that finding no longer exists in the scan results because it has been remediated. So if we wanted to look a little further about that, what we can do is we can go ahead and show any suppressed or, in this case, removed issues. We apply that filter, so now we can see all of the findings for the results, and then go back to our SQL injection. You can see now there's 62 results instead of 61, and that's because we should see the remediated result in here. And you can see that it's marked here as an R. So again, we can see what it looked like previously and see all that same information we saw in the IDE about the, you know, the overview and details about occurring on 304 in the MySQL provider class, but it's been remediated, so it is no longer part of our results. And then when we go back to our IDE, we can re-download the collaborative audit and continue to work on the next set of remediation that we need to do. So we bring in our latest results, and just by choosing that version, it will bring down the latest scan results, which when it has populated, we'll be able to see again. That we can go ahead and take this to the security auditor view to show all of them. SQL injection and line 304 is no longer a vulnerability. So again, we can go ahead and move on to another finding, start looking at the details, recommendations, diagram, analysis trace, and continue on with our work from here.